Welcome back, my dear friends, to the This Faith Things Bible Study, weekly Bible study. My name is Adeola Aduni, for those that have not met me yet. And if you are here with us for the very first time, welcome. God bless you. And I hope that this Bible study will be a blessing to you. Before we even start today, friends, I have three favors to ask of you, please, if you don't mind. The first one is to subscribe. Just hit the subscribe button down below, or you can hit it anywhere on the screen, wherever you see it pop up. Be free to subscribe. It's all free. Guys, it is completely free. You don't pay anything for me to pop into your subscription every week for free. So just hit the subscribe button. The second thing that I would like for you to do for me is to share this with your family, with your friends, with your enemies, whomever. Share it with everybody. The kingdom of God is for everyone. So share it with them kindly. And then the third thing is for you to leave down below in the comment section where you're coming from. Tell me about yourself. I want to know who you are. And probably one thing that you want me to help you with. If there is anything that you need understanding with, a topic in the Bible that you need understanding with, just be free and leave it down below. So as we always start every Bible study, let us pray and invite Jesus into the midst. Make sure that the Holy Spirit is dwelling with us and Father God sanctions all that we are requesting of Him. Father God, I just want to thank you for your children on today's Bible study. I thank you for their presence here and their obedience to coming back to study your word and understand who you are. Father Lord, as we are discussing kingdom beliefs and who it is for, who the kingdom of God is for, I pray that you yourself will minister to each and every one of us so that we truly know who your kingdom is for and how we can be kingdom focused and kingdom oriented. Lord, any type of distractions that may want to come in our way, I pray, Lord, that you will remove them in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray that your children will meet with you today, that they will have a divine encounter with you, that they will know that it's you, and that they know that they have met with you, Father God. I pray that you will anoint all of those that are listening unto you today, those that will be listening on the replay, Father God, that you will anoint them, their minds, so that they can be receptive to you, so that they will always be kingdom focused. Father God, thank you for what you've done in the past. We thank you for what you're going to do today, and we thank you for the future, Father God. Glory and honor be unto your holy name, for in Jesus' most precious name we've prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. So last time we spoke, friends, we were looking at the book of Matthew 6:25-34. And if you go into it, you can see that there's a discussion there that Jesus is now giving them examples. Don't worry about this. Don't worry about that. Don't worry about what is to come. Don't worry about anything in this life, but that you should be focused on heaven. He says that in Matthew 6:33. And if you go to Matthew 6:33, it says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you." If you read prior to Matthew 6:33, you will see what Jesus is referring to as all these things: the clothes that you're going to wear, the food that you're going to eat, the job that you're going to have. Of course, he didn't say it like that, but I'm paraphrasing and I'm just giving you a synopsis of what Jesus could have been referring to. What are all these things? These things that we sit down and allow to consume our thoughts, our everyday being. Jesus is telling us that if we seek the kingdom of God first, that everything that we desire for our life will be given unto us. And we said that in order for us to be kingdom focused, you must be able to get into the kingdom of God first. And I said that that will be a topic that we will get into. So for this week, we are now looking at who is the kingdom for. A lot of people in this world are confused as to who the kingdom is for, but Jesus lays it out for us in the book of Luke 18. Luke 18:9-17. It's quite a long passage. I want to read it, and we are going to focus on Luke 18:16. Okay? Luke 18:9. It says, "Also, he spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and one a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, 'God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all my possessions, and the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, 'God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Then they also brought infants to him that he might touch them. But when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called them to him and said, "Let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." You see, verse 16, it says, "But Jesus called them to him. Let the children come to me and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God." For those individuals is who the kingdom of God is for. This passage here, first of all, let's begin to dissect it a little bit. This passage here starts off with Jesus giving us a story, which we now call a parable. And if you study the Bible, you will begin to see that there was a point in time where Jesus began to speak in parables. And the reason why he did that was because there are some people in this world who have no interest in Jesus. They don't desire the kingdom of God. They don't desire Jesus. They don't want to hear what he has to say. And so Jesus had to begin to switch how he was teaching. Before, if you study the Bible, you will see that he was teaching prior to this time. He was teaching in regular words, like you and I are having a conversation. He will be able to converse with these individuals like normal, speaking regular English, whatever language that they're speaking back then. He was able to speak to them in that language. But it got to a point where Jesus, now his ministry had begun, and he needed to get only those who wanted to hear. He needed to draw towards him those who were truly for him. So he began to speak into parables. He began to speak in parables, rather, so that those who truly desired him, those that truly desired to understand who Jesus truly is, they will understand. Because the Bible tells us that if you really want to understand who Jesus is, that's why he spoke in parables, you will, because you will be searching and seeking for him. You will be searching and searching the scriptures, digging deep into the scriptures, and that is why he was speaking in parables. But he was now giving this story of a tax collector and a Pharisee. And so, friends, yes, he was using what was available to him in that day, but we can change it into whatever we want to change it into in this year that we're in. Friends, we can look at it in forms of people who are big executives compared to the homeless person. We can look at it as people who are doctors compared to someone who works at McDonald's. Friends, that is what Jesus was doing here. Those individuals who don't desire to understand who Jesus is, they will not understand the parable in which he spoke of here. But in this particular parable here, he is talking about two individuals, two men, a Pharisee and a tax collector. You should understand by now that the Pharisees, they thought so much of themselves. They were the elite class. They were well-read. They understood the law. That was their biggest thing, is that we understand the law. Who is this Jesus that's coming, telling us about the law that we instituted? That's how they thought. They thought that they were all in all. They thought that they were better than what they really were. And so you see here in this parable, it says here, the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. And he's praying aloud, which Jesus has already told us that you don't need to do. They're only doing it for show. This Pharisee was doing it for show. He began to pray. Thank God. God, I thank you that I'm not like all these other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. Can you imagine? He was so bold, he raised his eyes to heaven and he began to tell God, "God, I thank you that I'm not like these people. I thank you that I'm not a sinner," which he is. He was telling God that he thanks him because he's not a sinner like the tax collector. "I fast twice a week." First of all, if you study Jewish tradition, they were not supposed to fast twice a week anyway. There was a season in which they were supposed to be fasting. God never required them to be fasting twice a week. Then he now goes on to say, "I give tithes of all my possessions." You weren't supposed to do that. A tenth of what was earned is what was supposed to be given. You were not supposed to be given on all the possessions that you have. If you go back to the book of Deuteronomy 14, you will read it there. Deuteronomy 14, 22 through 23. You can read it there and understand it, that they were supposed to give a tenth of a certain thing that they had for themselves. And he was now boasting about what he was doing, making himself bigger about what he was doing. You can see right there from this Pharisee, friends, his heart was not right. His heart was not right. Remember, the Bible tells us that God searches the heart. Every person around you can just see the external. You can look good, dress well, speak well, have gone to the best school, have the best job, ride the best car, live in the most beautiful home. But if your heart is not right, they may not know it, friends, but God in heaven knows it. This Pharisee was telling God, I give you everything, God. I do everything that you required of me. Meanwhile, he was doing it for show, which we have already been told that you don't need to do. But this tax collector, the one who was considered the sinner, friends, look at it. Look at what it says. It says he's standing afar off. He wasn't interested in everybody knowing what he was praying to God about. He wasn't interested in raising his voice so the whole world can hear. He wasn't interested in making himself look good. He knew he was a sinner. He was so distraught at the fact that he's praying to this heavenly Father, and yet he's a sinner. He needed God to do what only God could do for him. And it says here, he would not as much raise his eyes to heaven. He would not as much as raise his eyes to heaven to pray to God. When somebody puts their head down, when somebody's discussing with you and your head has been dropped or hung low, what does that denote? It shows that there's a sign of shame. You are ashamed of what you have been doing. You are sad about what you have been doing. You're discouraged about what you have been doing. You don't want the individual whom you're looking at to look at you with some type of ill factor. I don't want to look at you factor. Disgust factor. This man, it says here, he did not raise his eyes to heaven, but he beat his breast, his chest, saying, God, be merciful to me. I am a sinner. I know I don't do right. I know I make mistakes. I know I cause trouble. I know I don't follow your laws and your tenets the way you have designed it for us to follow. But look at me as a sinner. Look at me and give me your forgiveness. The Pharisee did not do that. He may have been well read, all right. He may have the money in the world, all right. He may have looked more handsome, dressed better, spoke better, everything better than the tax collector. But Jesus now says to us in verse 14 that I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts themselves will be humbled. Everyone who is arrogant, who is prideful, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven that way. If you think that you are better than the next person because you went to that school or you went to this school, you have this job or that job, you drive this car or that car, you live in this community, you live in this type of house, you make this amount of money. If you think that's what's going to get you into heaven, you are sadly mistaken, my dear friend. That is what the Bible tells us. I tell you that this man went to his house justified rather than the other man. For everyone who exalts themselves, everyone who prides themselves, everyone who is arrogant, everyone who is boastful will be humbled. Human beings don't have to humble you. God will humble you. And if you don't believe me, go study about King Nebuchadnezzar. He was humbled for 7 years because he thought he was bigger than everybody else. He thought he could do what everybody else didn't want him to do. He was told several times not to do this. Serve God. Don't do it this way. Serve God. And he refused because why? He was a king. And God had to humble him for 7 years. Jesus is also telling us that you exalt yourself, you will be humbled. And he who humbles themselves will be exalted. There is no man that kneels before God that will not be raised up outside. If you are in your secret place like the tax collector, praying to God that, God, I want you to forgive me. I know I am a sinner. I make mistakes every day, God. I do what you don't want me to do every day, God. But please look down on me with merciful eyes. This is what the tax collector was doing. God will exalt you, no matter what your position is. Going back to the example that I gave when we first started, You have people who are doctors, who are lawyers, who are accountants, who are professors, who are scientists, who have these big time jobs. And sometimes they are very snobby, looking down on the person who cleans the hallway, who cleans the bathroom, who sweeps the streets, who takes out the trash, collects their trash. You're looking down on those persons, and God is telling you that you that's looking down on this individual, that's the one that's going to make it into heaven. That's the one that's going to acquire my kingdom. You that has this puffy heart, thinking that you're big because you are what? Somebody that God created you to be? You look down on everybody else and you think that you're going to make it to heaven? That is the reason, my dear friends, that prostitutes will make it to heaven and some doctors won't. That is the reason, my dear friends, that porn stars will make it to heaven and some professors won't. That is the reason why the bum on the street, the homeless person that you kicked and you walked past and you looked down on and you've cursed in your heart and you've said that he or she is there because of what they've done, which you have no clue about, as opposed to you working in corporate America or corporate anywhere, your country, and you're working for your country, you have this big time job with your briefcase, your suitcase, you're walking into your office with your nice tie, with your nice dress, with your pumps, stiletto heels, with your Louis Vuitton bag. God is saying that you're not making it because your heart is not right. Because you've exalted yourself more than what you should have exalted yourself. You're not humbled. You don't give to the poor. You don't help the poor. You don't do for other people. You only want me, me, me. That's what you are desiring. You are exalting yourself before the King of all kings. And he's telling you, you won't be justified that way. You cannot be justified that way. This tax collector represents those individuals whose heart is right with God, who desires, they know that they are sinner. I know I'm a sinner. I commit sin on a daily basis. I've only been awake for about 2 hours this morning. And Lord knows what I've done wrong. And so I humbly request of his forgiveness. Because who am I? If God on his throne should sit down on his throne, which he has already made the earth his footstool, and he now steps on my thinking, or on anyone's thinking, we're going to have a problem. But God is so merciful. He is so gracious to us. But now let's go into verse 15. You see here, verse 15, Jesus was well known at this point. He was sought as and thought of as a wise teacher. And you can imagine, just in regular society of today, when you encounter a man or a woman of God who is just so blessed by God, and you can tell that the anointing of God is on them, most people want them to be touched by that individual. You want that person to lay their hands on you, to lay their hands on your head. And so we see here that the children, the infants, they were brought to him for him to touch them, but the disciples, they were shooing them away. No, this is Jesus. Maybe they didn't want them to be touched, or maybe that they felt that Jesus should not be bothered, which happens in real life today. You don't want to bother the man or woman of God, but Jesus says no, call them, let them come towards me, let them come towards me so that I can touch them. And he used them as his example. Let the children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. That's the answer. Verse 16. For of such is the kingdom of God. For people like these children is who the kingdom of God is for. Jesus is saying that if you are like a child, if you behave like a child, you think like a child. And let's dissect, what is a child? A child is a very innocent person, little person. They're innocent. They tell you the truth when you want to hear it, and when you don't want to hear it. They're very innocent in their nature. They're very playful and joyous. It's when we begin to teach them unnecessary things that their attitude changes. But Jesus is saying that it's when you are like these children that you enter into the kingdom of God. You have to get to a point that you don't think much of yourself. Children don't really think much of themselves. They're not arrogant. They don't think that they're better than their friends. That's why when you place a group of children together, what happens? They begin to gravitate to one another because they don't think I'm better than you. They don't think that, you know, my outfit looks better than yours, or my shoes are better than yours, or my parents have a better job. Children don't think like that. And Jesus is telling us that it's like people like these children. It's for people like these children that the kingdom of God is for. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter. Friends, he says it here by himself in verse 17. If you are not like this little child, if you don't think like this child, if you don't reason like this child, if you don't behave like this child, you are not going to get into the kingdom of God. So if we're trying to be kingdom focused, you cannot be kingdom focused not trying to pursue the kingdom itself. You cannot be kingdom focused outside of the kingdom. You need to be working and walking towards the kingdom. And he has already given you the answer here that if you desire to get into this kingdom, you must receive it like a child. You must be sincere like a child. You know, children have a very funny way of being very sincere, and they tell you the honest to brutal truth. They don't lie for any reason. Unless you've taught that child how to lie, they will tell you the truth. And that is what Jesus is looking for. He knows that we're sinners. He came and he died for us. So he knows. He knows that you are a sinner. He knows that I'm a sinner. He knows that I can't make it without him. He knows that. But he wants you to know that. He wants you to know that you can't make it without him. He wants you to know that he died for you. He wants you to be humbled before him. So let him exalt you. He wants you to come prostrating, laying face flat on the floor when you are speaking with him, praying to him, because you are a sinner. Don't be like the Pharisee that stood boldly and said that, I'm not a sinner. I thank you, God, that I'm not a sinner. I'm not an extortioner. I'm not an adulterer. Don't be like that Pharisee who was boasting of himself and what he does. God could care less about your tithing. You could be paying tithes faithfully. In fact, you could be paying 90% tithes every Sunday if you want to. And you may not get to heaven, friends. There may be a person who's only paying 10%, but their heart is right with God, and they will get there. That's why a lot of people that you think will get into the kingdom won't be there. That's why you need to focus on yourself. Focus on yourself to getting into this kingdom of God, because it's going to be glorious, friends. Even while you're here on earth, when you're operating under the mist of heaven, the kingdom of heaven, God does what only God can do for you. No man can do this for you, my dear friends. You see, when a man and a woman are courting, and let's use the woman for instance, she's trying to impress the husband's family. She wants to dress well, she sits well at the dinner table, she speaks good grammar, she doesn't want to make a mistake. Why? Because she knows that they are paying attention to her, and her desire is to do what? To enter into their family. She wants to impress them, she doesn't want to make a mistake. Even if she and the person she's courting had a misunderstanding, if she gets to the family house, she changes her demeanor, her facial expressions are different, she doesn't make any sign for them to know that there was a misunderstanding. Why? Because she wants to get into the family. It's the same thing for the man. He wants to impress the girl's family so he can also be accepted. So if we're doing that for earthly families, friends, if we're trying to impress the person that we want to marry, their family, to enter into their family so that for we ladies, our last names can be changed to their last name or surname for those that are watching outside of the United States, what makes you think you shouldn't do that for the kingdom of God? What makes you think that you should not be chasing desperately to get into the kingdom of God? God wants you to be in his kingdom. The only way that you can fully function as a woman or a man, as children in his kingdom, is first of all, you need to desire to get into the kingdom. He tells us here in Luke 18, verse 16, let the children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. His kingdom is for all of us, but you first of all must humble yourself. Think low of yourself. You are not that big. Don't be that big and that boastful that you won't get into the kingdom. The kingdom is for all of us, friends. The kingdom of God is for all of us, but you have to do your part. Play your part the proper way so that you can enter into his kingdom. Friends, next week we are going to continue to look at the kingdom of God, how we can get into it and how we are supposed to behave when we are in his kingdom. I hope that this message, this Bible study of today has helped you, it has blessed you, And if you can do those three things, subscribe, share, and comment, I will be so grateful. Please come back next week so we can continue on with our study of what it means to be kingdom focused. God bless you, my dear friends. Alrighty. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Jesus, you are the best. You are the best, Jesus.